Welcome back to our WESH 2 special, State versus Zimmerman after the verdict. The shooting death of Trayvon Martin shined the spotlight on a controversial Florida law.
Commonly called stand your ground, opponents call the law a license to kill. It was one of the first defenses George Zimmerman used, although his lawyers did not end up pursuing it at his trial.
But it did come up during his trial when George Zimmerman's old criminal justice professor was called to the stand to explain how he taught that law.
When you have a reasonable apprehension of death or grievous bodily harm, and the term reasonable is obviously has two components. So there's a subjective component, meaning that I feel like I'm in fear. In my mind, I feel like I'm in fear of death or grievous bodily harm. But when stuff hits the fan, you're judged by jurors. And your actions have to meet a reasonable standard objectively.
State versus Zimmerman pushed Stand Your Ground into the spotlight, and to talk about it tonight is the man who wrote that law, State Senator David Simmons from Altamont Springs. Senate Democratic Leader Chris Smith today says he now wants a reexamination of all self-defense laws. He says they are too fuzzily defined and broadly drawn to make clear who can use deadly force and when. Before we get your reaction, let's go ahead and define this.
Yeah, here's the exact wording. An innocent victim who is A, not engaged in an unlawful activity, B, is where he or she has a lawful right to be, C, does not provoke the use of force, and D, acts reasonably in the use of deadly force in defending himself or herself, may stand his or her ground rather than flee.
So what about Senator Smith's proposal to reexamine all self-defense laws?
Well, it needs to be understood what Stand Your Ground is. The state of Florida in 2005 and prior to that had a minority position, a position that was rejected by a majority of the courts and states other than the state of Florida, that have taken the position that if in fact you are confronted with someone who's using deadly force against you, then the courts will not second guess you. They will not make a decision for you that you have to flee. Florida had the rule, which was a minority position in the nation, that everyone who was an innocent victim had to try to flee rather than use deadly force to protect themselves. The fact of it is that puts the life of the criminal above the life of an innocent victim. So an innocent victim, the United States Supreme Court, for example, said that they would not re-examine the decision-making of a person who is an innocent victim as to whether they try to disarm the assailant or whether they fled. The fact of it is that Florida followed a minority position when I addressed this issue with Representative Baxley back in 2005. And so it's only a very small portion of the concept of self-defense. The Zimmerman case did not involve the issue of Stand Your Ground because he alleged that he was pinned to the ground and therefore couldn't flee. Florida followed the rule that you have to flee if in fact you have a chance to flee, except it has an exception, that you can't flee because you're not able to flee. He was not able to flee. There was no opportunity if he was pinned to the ground to flee. So the issue of Stand Your Ground doesn't even come into play in the Zimmerman case. That's the reason you didn't hear anything about the Stand Your Ground law except tangentially.
But we're sure hearing a lot about it today. It is part of the national discussion, the national lexicon. I want to bring in our experts. I know
I got something. The number one question I see on Twitter and I get asked is, didn't Trayvon Martin have the right to stand his ground? And the answer is absolutely yes. But self-defense is not a mutually exclusive thing, meaning that only one person can assert at the same time. There is very often where you'll have two people get in a fight, both of them will actually get charged with battery, and they will actually can both raise self-defense in their separate trials. Okay, and they could actually both be found not guilty because, like we heard here from the professor, it is a subjective belief, and it all depends on which jury believes the fight started. And so, aside from Stand Your Ground, to everybody is asking, when Trayvon Martin was, if he was confronted by George Zimmerman, he absolutely had the right to stand his ground. But if George Zimmerman was confronted by Trayvon Martin, George Zimmerman absolutely had the right to stand his ground as well. It's not mutually exclusive.
And we made the Stand Your Ground exception to fleeing a very, very limited exception. We made sure that it only applied to people who are, in fact, innocent victims. They cannot be engaged in any kind of unlawful activity. And we use the word activity, not just unlawful act. You can't be, for example, a drug runner and use it. So you cannot be involved in, and by the way, the state in other parts of this state, the prosecution have been alleging that having a parking violation constitutes an unlawful activity so that you can't use Stand Your Ground. But you cannot use Stand Your Ground if, in fact, you're engaged in an unlawful activity, if, in fact, you have provoked the use of force, or you are not where you have the right, you don't have the right to be, and you use excessive force.
Let me ask our experts, have you used Stand Your Ground or had it used against you?
Our office uses it a lot in the cases we have about, the office I operate has about 2,000 open criminal cases every day. We've had very recently a Stand Your Ground hearing in front of a judge in Seminole County. The cases, when they come up, they come up. Just to reiterate something that the senator said, before there was Stand Your Ground, I represented a fella a few years ago, without telling war stories, about this duty to retreat. This was a real thing. This was not a slight thing, in which he was absolutely confronted, and the prosecutor argued in the trial before Stand Your Ground that my client could have gotten away if he could have retreated, even though by retreating he would have run over the guy that was attacking him. That's how to the absurd it got when you started talking about whether or not you needed to retreat. This issue of Stand Your Ground, the senator is exactly right. This was never an issue here. It came out, it's being talked about now again, because in the beginning of the case, when nobody knew any of the facts, those were the words that were used. This is the thing that happened. He stood his ground.
Let me interrupt and just say that those words came from Sanford Police. They said that's why they didn't arrest him.
Whatever it was, but yeah. You know what? It didn't matter if it was Stand Your Ground. If he had the same self-defense case, they invoked this immunity part of Stand Your Ground, but if they analyzed the case and saw a viable self-defense case, then they were still saying the same thing. The point is that the senator's right. This never became a Stand Your Ground case. According to George Zimmerman, he couldn't go anywhere anyway, and he was knocked off his feet at the immediate moment there was a confrontation. So there was no Stand Your Ground issue here. It's being talked about now again because of the verdict and because that was what was initially spoken about.
And what's important is that the immunity that is provided for in that statute, that immunity is improperly called a Stand Your Ground immunity. It is a self-defense immunity that simply says that if, in fact, you do have a self-defense claim, and maybe Stand Your Ground will be part and parcel of that, that you can go ahead and have a hearing in front of the judge before the trial. In order to save the expense and the time and the effort and the trouble of a trial, you can go ahead and have a hearing in advance of the trial, and you, the defendant, have the burden of proving by a preponderance of evidence that you're innocent.
And George Zimmerman had this option, and his attorneys decided not to do it.
And you know why? Because now it's very obvious. None of his statements came into this trial. It's one of the aberrations of all time that he was never cross-examined by the authorities. It's amazing to me.
He would have had this Stand Your Ground motion, which is a motion to dismiss, and he would have asserted the Stand Your Ground, he would have been subject to cross-examination by the prosecutors. And I think the reason why Stand Your Ground became so relevant in this case is because it's arguably why he was not arrested in the first place. And that statute puts a lot of power in the police officer's hand. It takes the power away from the prosecutor's office. It takes the power away from a jury. And here you had a police officer that decided not to arrest George Zimmerman, and you had two parents that are asking, well, I have a dead kid. You decided not to arrest someone, you're not going to hold them accountable, you're not going to have a prosecutor's office, you're not going to have a jury, no one's going to decide except for you, this one person, because of the statute.
And Alicia, it's also very hard for supporters of the Trayvon Martin family to hear the definition of Stand Your Ground and say this applies to Trayvon Martin, that he was not doing anything illegal, he was where he was supposed to be, he was walking to his father's home. They say, did not provoke anything because he was walking home and acted reasonably in defending himself. That perhaps, yes, everyone admits there was a fight, but they're saying Trayvon didn't. So they say Stand Your Ground applies to him. It's still very difficult for supporters, you know, across the country to understand how Stand Your Ground works. It not in the favor of the person who's dead.
Absolutely. You heard John Guy say it in his closing argument. Didn't Trayvon Martin have the right to defend himself, and in essence talking about stand your ground. But the issue is like Richard said, two people can claim it. And here, the issue with the prosecutors in this case, especially with the culmination of their closing argument, they didn't give the jurors a story. The jurors needed a story. They can't fill in the gaps of whatever the prosecutors...
Or an alternative. I think an alternative explanation. They never gave a of the fight.
So. Absolutely. Go ahead.
And they have to invoke it for him. And they never did that.
Yep.
Trayvon Martin in there. These prosecutors walked into this courtroom and never, ever represented him. They never represented his story. When you have no choice, the jury makes the choices they have. But who made the story? As Alicia says, who went in there for him, if you're the state attorney, who went in there and said, he has that right just like George Zimmerman, and here's what happened. You never heard that.
And Jeff, it seems like to me, having listened to it for 3 weeks, this prosecution got so caught up in all of the drama and all of the big words and the profanity and just driving that home again and again, and perhaps really missed that part of the narrative, trying to perhaps go over the top, appealing to a jury, a panel of six women. And obviously, they just didn't buy it. And I think they may have missed the ball by going with so much emotion, absent the evidence that was necessary. And you just didn't have that part of the narrative about who started the fight, how it all evolved. There was just this giant hole in the case that they just did not seem to be able to fill.
And Rachel Gentile provided the perfect segue into George Zimmerman starting this fight. And I'll be honest, I mean, I listened to it, and I tuned out Bernie a few times during this trial, but I tried to listen to it. I never once heard him say, here's what happened.
Exactly.
We heard it from Rachel Gentile. George Zimmerman came up to him. You heard the last moments before Trayvon started, had to defend himself, and then you heard him say, what are you doing? Get off me. That's because George Zimmerman hit him, and George Zimmerman started his fight. You never heard those
exactly.
words from the prosecutor's mouth.
Mm-hmm.
George Zimmerman started his fight. You heard allusions to it, but I mean, they left out the whole gap, the most important gap in the whole case, from the prosecution's perspective.
Well, while the trial was on and we were all together, we talked about this alternative, all of us talked about this alternative scenario. Why not say that maybe it was a struggle over a gun, that the gun was already out? Why not paint that vivid picture? And it really does seem like the key missed opportunity.
And there were so many times you'd think they were getting there, especially in closing arguments.
A little bit
with
of that.
Both sides.
Yeah.
It was like, oh, here it comes.
It.
They're going to tell it. And then they would stop just short
right.
of giving the jury some type of hardcore evidence that they could use to convict George Zimmerman. And I think that the issue that they had was because it would be speculative. It would be circumstantial. And you heard the prosecutor say, there's two people that can tell you this story.
Right.
One of them is a liar and one of them is dead. So for them to tell you exactly what happened, it's difficult. That puts them in a difficult position because they don't know what happened. The person that knows what happened is dead.
And don't you think they asked too many questions that they themselves couldn't answer as prosecutors?
But they could.
You guys, the defense people, are the ones who are supposed to be asking the questions to help create reasonable
right.
doubt, not
yes.
the prosecutor.
They couldn't.
You know what
doubt.
Happened? That I think their theory originally was that they were going to say George Zimmerman used that flashlight, the bigger flashlight, because they kept talking about opening statement. There's two flashlights. There's two flashlights. And I think what really sunk their ship
yes.
was when they handed it to Dr. DeMaio, mm-hmm. and he goes, "Couldn't this be a deadly weapon?" And he laughed.
No, this thing is. Couldn't do anything. That's exactly
right. He laughed. He said, "This thing?" Because it couldn't do anything. I really think that was going to be their theory, is that the gun wasn't out, but the flashlight. Because remember, we heard it. You heard this hitting, didn't you? You heard this hitting. They were going to argue that it was like everybody's saying it's a big maglite flashlight, and it's a little Duracell thing you get with the toy store, you know? And
attach it to your key ring.
See, I don't even accept their premise that only two people can tell a story. I don't accept that premise. George Zimmerman can tell a story. Trayvon Martin is dead. But you're the state attorney. You're telling the story for Trayvon Martin, and you abandon the story. When you give this jury no choice, how can you fault them for deciding on what they were given? The jury instruction they got is a series of intentional acts. Did you ever hear a series of acts? No. Their story focused on the act, and when you focus on the act alone, I think you can't help but do what this jury did. There is a series of intentional acts that get you to this fight. There is an inference you can make from the evidence if you're doing what attorneys do and infer logically and make an argument based on the evidence you heard. You can make that case for Trayvon Martin because he's dead. That's what prosecutors do every day in my courtrooms. I don't know how we didn't hear it in this case. How did it happen that we didn't
hear it? And a lot of people are asking that, Jeff, and since you're kind of going there, I want to get you to answer this, because there's been a lot of talk that the prosecution didn't try hard enough and that, in fact, were they trying to throw this case? People are pointing out the fact that they're from Jacksonville, they're not from our community, they didn't really truly have a stake. So what do you give any merit to that?
No, I don't give any merit to that. No, I think that they did the job the way they saw it. I just don't think they saw it well. And I will say this, too. I think both sides, and I'm going to say this, I think both sides were affected, even though this prosecution pushed this case to trial. It cannot be understated how this judge's arbitrary early deadline affected both sides. It cannot be understated. This was amazing to me, and I think you see that they were not ready.
If you want to talk about how to convict George Zimmerman, I'll tell you right now. First, you do what prosecutors do to me every day. You don't charge one charge. Prosecutors are allowed to charge in the alternative. They're allowed to charge conflicting theory offenses. You charge, if you really want to get a conviction on something, what you do is you give that jury so many possible choices that they're going to have to make a solemn-like choice. Do they split the baby? You charge him with second-degree murder. You charge him with a separate count of manslaughter by an intentional act. You charge him with manslaughter by culpable negligence. You charge him with aggravated battery just simply for shooting him, even though we all know he's died. You charge him with aggravated assault. If you want to keep going, you charge him with misdemeanor assault. And then you have seven things, and if on the prosecutor, I want to get a conviction for something, I argue, okay, maybe George Zimmerman started this fight, maybe he was justified in his shooting, if you want to believe that, but he wasn't justified in when he assaulted or when he battered Trayvon Martin, and maybe he did hit Trayvon Martin. And then you do not, if you want to cross, because I'll tell you who would have convicted, got a conviction in this case. You put George Zimmerman on that stand in front of Bernie de la Ronda, you have a conviction for something because you don't believe George Zimmerman. They put in all of his statements. They did not need to do that. There is no law that requires it. They could have put in a few statements, enough to get them past that judgment of acquittal issue. It would have forced George Zimmerman to get on the stand and testify, because you can't introduce your own statements.
It was a huge error.
Huge error.
And here's the thing. The more George Zimmerman talked, the worse his credibility got.
You mean the 5 minutes that you got to hear that? That's all it was.
And don't forget that his wife still faces a felony charge because he sat there mute in the courtroom during that bond hearing and let his wife via telephone, if you remember, because there was all of these extraordinary measures taken for the family's safety. She got on there and said, oh, we're broke. But at the same time, we knew later they had a six-figure defense fund, and that seemed to all be orchestrated by George Zimmerman himself in those jail calls, and it cost his defense. I mean, it pushed them back by weeks, months, and tons of dollars because of his, if you want to say, lie by omission, where he did not say anything. And he always seemed to get himself in trouble. Jeff told me this all the time. Whenever he opened his mouth, he seemed to get in trouble. And if he would have been subjected to cross-examination, this could have been a whole different outcome.
And can you imagine him being cross-examined? And Jeff and I talk about this all the time. He had about 5 minutes of pressured challenge conversation with Officer Serino and did terrible. His posture got different. His answers were shaky. And then you have the state that continued to play these testimonies and say, well, there's inconsistencies, but his main story remained the same. He said self-defense every single time he was questioned.
And we want to actually play that for you right now, because that was a key point when we heard from Sanford Detective Chris Serino. In his direct, Prosecutor Bernie de la Rionda pushing Detective Serino for any inconsistencies and exaggerations in the interview with George Zimmerman. Let's listen.
Would you raise your right hand? Do you solemnly swear or affirm that the testimony you give will be the truth?
And do you recall, I think either you uttered it or Mr. O'Meara uttered it on behalf of the defendant, exaggeration. Do you recall what that was about?
Pertains to the defendant's statements.
You felt he was exaggerating certain parts of it?
Among other things.
I can't lead you, so did you feel, in terms of exaggeration, what did you mean when you said that he was exaggerating parts of his interview?
How I felt, based on...
Okay, no, what I'm getting is inconsistent. You were asked specifically about exaggeration. Did you feel he had exaggerated the manner in which he was hit?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So they also challenged the defense claim that Martin punched Zimmerman 25 to 30 times, but Jeff...
He got it right away. He said, I don't think you were hit 25 to 30 times. And then he's asked about why he got out of the car. And he said, I needed to get directions. I needed to get an address. And then it wasn't that he needed to get an address. He was just going in the same direction. And the other detective says, George, that's following him. And you see him sink in his chair.
Yep, his whole demeanor changed.
These terrible words that people were getting excited about, did he profile him? Within a week, you knew he profiled him. Their basic case showed that George Zimmerman profiled Trayvon Martin. You can call it dancing with the stars if you want, if it makes you feel better. He profiled him. He got out. He called in 10 seconds. He was going to the store to buy lunch for his kid. He left with a gun in his pocket. In 10 seconds.
Bullet in the chamber.
With a bullet in the chamber, 10 seconds, he's calling in and saying, I see a suspicious guy. In that 5 minutes, the detective says, what was suspicious? Stops the tape. What was suspicious about him? He wasn't walking fast enough in the rain. Next part, he seems to be on drugs. Why do you think that? Well, he's just not acting right. Come on. This is why you don't need a following law. When you get out of your car after this, and those are the reasons you're out there, wanna be cop? Heck yeah, he was. He got out of the car because he had a gun in his pocket. That's why. And when he followed him, he did get confronted by Trayvon Martin, who had every reason to do that. Why are you following me? And you know he said that because Rachel Gentile heard it.
Yep.
Why are you following me? Mm-hmm. The next part may not have been heard. Do you have a problem? I don't have a problem. Here's what I think happened. I think you can infer it from the evidence. I think, even giving George Zimmerman the benefit of the doubt, Trayvon Martin may have punched him. And when George Zimmerman goes down, I think that's when he pulled his gun.
Yeah.
Because he had his gun behind him. He showed you where it was. If he'd have laid on his back, he'd have been laying on his gun. If he wasn't laying on his gun, then Trayvon Martin's knees were blocking.
Trayvon sees the gun.
Trayvon sees the gun. They're laying on top of each other. They're fighting
right
over the gun. That's when you get a scream like that on the phone. Help me, help me. Nobody ever asked him to scream again. When he described his scream, he didn't go, I was going, help you. That woeful sound you hear. He said, help me, help me. He told the guy that not...
That's what a jury needed to hear. If you want a conviction, you have to put in facts like that. You have to give the jury something to visualize.
Listen to that. I don't mean to cut you off, Lisa. I just visualized in my head. I could totally see it. Trayvon's upset because this guy's fault. I'm sure he punches him, but then the wannabe cop immediately goes to pull out his gun,
exactly.
And Trayvon's like, oh my God, this guy's crazy.
Exactly.
And of course he's going to grab him, and he's going to bash his head in because he's like, the guy's crazy. He's going to shoot me. And so then, you know, that story, you tell it to a jury of five women, and then I'll tell you what, I spent 3 days in God's plan. He's getting convicted of something.
Three witnesses came in to tell what a terrible fighter he was. If he's getting beat up like that, you think he's going to have the presence of mind to get his gun out then and shoot him? No, he's going to look. He was 0.5 on the guy's athletic scale. I mean, sure, he's not doing that. That gun was out.
And don't you think?
But who made that case?
And don't you think the prosecution leaned too heavily on the profanity as evidence of the ill will?
I was waiting for him to say it in his press conference.
Exactly. And that's the sense that many of you have made, the case that this was overcharged. It never should have been a second degree murder case, but they kept leaning on the profanity as their crutch again and again.
Which was fine in the opening statements. Which was fine to start in the opening statements, but you're right. Let's not dwell on that. Let's get to the point. Let's connect the dots. Even my own kids said, Mommy, can't somebody out here just connect the dots and just come out and say what happened?
Jeff Dean just did it.
I want to ask you about Rachel Gentile, because we've kind of danced around this issue, but she was one of the, she was probably the second most person that people were talking about after
yes.
this trial. And she came out of nowhere, and she did not come out of central casting for this. And she maybe was not refined, but here's a young lady who speaks three languages and got on the stand when she obviously didn't want to and explained that she lied because she wanted to protect Sabrina Fulton and stood up under a withering cross-examination.
Absolutely, and I think you had Don West, who unsuccessfully impeached her because I think there was an extreme miscommunication between the two of them. But one thing about Rachel Gentile, even though you had Don West trying to point out that she was not consistent, that she wasn't telling the truth, she was real.
She was real.
She was
yes.
real. She came there and gave you all that she had. And I do think that the state probably could have coached her a little bit better, maybe if they would have spent some more time with her before the trial started. But you had her, and she told you she didn't want to be there.
Mm-hmm.
And any lie that he pointed out that she told made sense. It made sense. And when he was trying to condemn her for, well, why didn't you call the police first? And her response was, you don't watch First 48. People laughed, but that's true.
That's true.
Here she is, the very last person that this teenage boy talks to before he's shot and killed, and no one calls her? It's crazy.
And even on the second day when she came back, she was still Rachel Gentile. She was a little gentle, but she still stuck to her guns. And as Alicia's saying, she was straightforward. No matter, you know, how much he tried, oh, you can't read cursive writing, which to me was just more of an embarrassment than anything
else. I don't
think
Don West did it on purpose. I know Don personally. I just went through it. I mean, interrupt you. I don't think he did it on purpose.
Then why did he do it?
I don't think he knew.
But what point does that mean? I mean, yes, she got the girl to write the letter for her, to give to Sabrina. But why was that? I mean, what could be gained at all by that? Nothing.
Gail, the only reason I cut you off is I just don't think he knew that, because to me it looked cruel. If it was on purpose, it was cruel. We discussed this, I think, with Lisa yesterday. I was discussing. I'm like, even if I'd known that, I would never brought it up, because there's no way, knowing who Don West is and I know him, I don't think he did it on purpose. I think it caught him off guard. I don't think he ever even thought to ask her, did you write that?
All right, guys, we want to get final thoughts as we come to the close of this session here with you guys, and we'll start with Bob. Closing thoughts about this
one. Yeah, you know, what I want to do is pay tribute to what I think is the X factor in this trial that nobody has talked about, and that is the pastors of Sanford, who sat there, not only Sanford, but across Central Florida. They sat there, and some of those elders from Sanford remember in their lifetime the murders of Harry T. Moore and Harriet Moore being blown up in their house on Christmas, and they're concerned about this idea of equal justice. I had one of them tell me they just wanted to see George Zimmerman be held accountable for his actions. He was, and they were satisfied with that.
Bob, thanks. Our conversation, discussion, and debate does not end here. We kind of just scratched the surface. We invite you to weigh in on the case and the verdict on our WESH.com and Facebook page, as well as on Twitter.
And there are still plenty of developments that we will stay on top of in the days, weeks to come, and of course, the months to come.
Yeah, beginning with the ongoing protests and the new legal avenues being explored, we'll have much on WESH 2 News at 11 and tomorrow on WESH 2 News Sunrise. Thanks so much for joining us.
To the living we owe respect, to the dead we owe the truth. We have been respectful to the living. We have done our best to assure due process to all involved. And we believe that we brought out the truth on behalf of Trayvon Martin.
The verdict is the verdict, and it can't be changed. But I think as a community, we have to pull closer together and try to make sense of everything.
It's a tragic loss of life. It not only will impact, of course, Trayvon Martin's family and all those that knew him forever and ever. This event itself also impacts George Zimmerman forever and ever and ever. This is something no one gets over. There's no winners here.
Freedom is kind of a new concept to him all over again. As bizarre as it sounds, he really is free to move about this country and do whatever he pleases for the first time in a long time.
What I hope for is that this wouldn't have never happened and he would still be here. That's my hope.
For Trayvon to rest in peace, we must all be peaceful.